Okay, I should be on. Should be on again. So. And it should run now with the hardware encoding. So let's see. I mean, please just let me know if there is a if there is lag. Obviously, I was just continue. So I will start again with the server. Let's start this up. And now with the client. Okay, so now I try to change it now. Yeah, very probably. I mean, let's see. So you should see now the client running. And let's see if the, mean the lag is so like the local lag here is like it's okay. I think it's okay. Now, I mean it's not good and the machine is kind of exploding almost, but it's there. Okay. So, is it better now? Let's just see. I mean, it really looks very laggy. It looks laggy in my preview window. So I'm not sure if that's really like how you see it, because that would not be good. So, okay. Okay, good. Then I will just go on. Okay. Good. Okay. Good. So what you've seen now is Hey. Hey Indy, what's up? Okay, so now I'm nervous. Okay. So hello. Hello, Indy. So what I originally wanted to do, and I will try to just stick to the plan. Let's just see if the lag is killing us completely or not. Is to start showing the two. Now it's two clients at once, so let's just try to do that one more, because I kind of want to make now a stress test for the robustness, let's say. So let's fire up one client and then let's fire up a second client. Let's see what is going on. So let's see how that works. Okay, but if that really is not working, I really need to do something. Okay, Indy, so you saw two clients and it was okay. So how's it for the others? So that really depends on how to go on. Okay, you're mobile. Okay. It's not lagging. Okay. Okay, then anyway, I will say if it's laggy from one viewer, then it's already too laggy anyway. And so what we're doing now anyway is completely ridiculous. So we shouldn't do that anyway, so I will try to improve on that. I didn't fully plan to do that now, so that's a bit forcing me in doing that now. But well, that's the beauty of live coding, just trying to do these things. Okay, thanks, Nautic. So okay, I think I'm the guilty one. Okay, I think I'm the guilty guy. Okay, so let's try to improve on that. And now, as I have so many like wonderful developers here in that stream, that will not be a problem, because even if I screw it up, then you will just jump right in and tell me how to do it in the correct way. Good. So let's see. Let's maybe start with the server. Let's start with the server. I think it's there. Is that the server? Yes. So what we do here now, as you can see, we're having our wonderfully sophisticated game loop, which is just an endless loop for now. And we are actually just really trying, kind of pumping out stuff all the time. Okay. Yeah. Thanks, Indy. I think we need to improve on that anyway. So yeah. Let's just start with a better strategy on what to put out in the server. So how often and what, but for now it's more the frequency. So how often do we update the client from the server side? So this is now the main issue. And there is several approaches that we could take. I'm just thinking. I mean, anyway, there are several issues with this server code as it stands now. I mean, if you look at it. There's just two things wrong right away. So one thing is that we only send stuff back if we receive something. I mean, that's kind of stupid. So we would need to send something even if we are not receiving currently something. Or at least if you're not receiving. Okay, better and fluid again. So that's, yeah. Yeah, turn server and client off. That's why it works again. Yeah, and thanks for doing Prost. So yeah, what I said, I mean, the problem is that as it stands now, we are on the one hand, we're sending too few information. That's just not like correct from a logical point of view. On the other hand, when we receive stuff, so when receive okay is not zero, so we receive something. E.g. input information. But then, so if we receive something, then we go like full steam, and then we're just going crazy and we're sending out each frame if there is something coming in. So we might actually not send each frame, but we send at a very high rate, and that's just not good. So yeah, indeed, that's right. Yeah. So, yeah, that's right. Yeah, we will actually we'll try to do it just now. Yeah. So what we need to do, and there is now several ways. I'm thinking of a quick and of a quick way to maybe stabilize it, so that we just maybe don't do too much optimization, just to keep the stream alive for now. Let's see. Let's think. So what if we just kind of put some kind of thread sleep and some kind of delay in the into this whole server loop. I'm just thinking. Or if we kind of measure the time between the messages that we send, and we just decide for a specific update frequency, and then we pack messages together. I mean, let's now go for like a simple and naive brute force approach, and let's just see how much that affects the rate, the update rate, and then that's the CPU stress. Let's see how that does it. I'm just thinking how we do that best. Yeah, I think we need to do some. We need to do some counting of time, actually. But I think we will do that just in milliseconds, and I think it's called STL net get ticks. I think that's what you can use here. Let's just see how that works. Sorry, that's here. Yeah, so that's just the milliseconds here. Let's try that. Let's just try that. So what we want to do is to measure the time in. So let's say, what was that? So that's UINT32. Last message update. So then each time around, Okay, so we'll just get the ticks. And we'll just add them. And if let me just think. No, we would just actually, yeah, no, that's fine. Yeah, we will just do it like this. Let's do it like that for now. I mean, we could also, yeah, it's not so easy now how to do that actually. Yeah, let's do it in a naive way. Let's just say, so if, let's just say, so if you are at UN32, select the current tick. It's just STL get ticks. And if current ticks minus so I'm completely stupid now. So what I do is, okay, I get all the ticks. So I get the current ticks. I need to just sum them up. And yeah. That's right. Yeah. So let's see if that's greater than 20. Let's do 5. Let's say we do 10 updates per second only. So only if that is greater than 100. We send the message and so that should work. And then we set our last message up to the current ticks. So let's see if that already slows down the frequency or I just completely screwed up. Let's see. So let's compile that again. And let's start the server. I mean, anyway, now all is good. I hope. I mean, good is, I mean, it's not really good, actually. Let's look at that. Oops. So, I mean, it still takes already 68%. So, anyway, we should send it to sleep. Let's just, anyway, do an STL delay of, let's say, I don't know, 10 milliseconds. Normally that already does a lot. If we give it some room to breathe. So let's see. Ah, that makes it that makes it worse now. Okay. Yeah, that doesn't really help a lot. Okay. Maybe I'm just to be sure. Let's see if that makes a difference. Yeah, it's slightly better. I mean, it's not really good, but I mean, OBS alone takes 25%, so yeah. And I'm still of kind in a busy loop here. So, okay. Let's just see how that works. The client just stays the same. Let's see. I mean, of course, we also spam from the client side a lot of stuff. I think it's a bit better. I mean, what you see here is, but that is now, of course, kind of completely. But you see a bit of pattern that the packages are sent not so often anymore. I mean, that's a bit of a improvement already. So, but I don't like that it is now sending that so often. So something is wrong a bit. Something is a bit off now. So something is a bit off. So let's see. Let's just remove that again. Yeah, but that's what it's all about, isn't it? I mean, that's a real thing. And I think it's even more fun to see me struggle. So, okay, but now that stops. I mean, the funny thing is, that's the expected behavior at least. So, I mean, what I did now, I mean, I'm really kind of just trying things out now. So if I remove that, but we're still in that case here. If I remove that, of course we don't send any authoritative information back to the client. So it's okay that the client looks like this. That's expected. So the guy is just standing up there at 0, 0 essentially, because that's okay. That's he never received an update. So that's fine. And when I close it down, there is nothing is sent from the client anymore, so the server is like pausing. Okay, that's fine. That's actually okay. I just don't completely get why the phenomena is like this when I just put that in. Let's try that out. What is going I mean, maybe it's crap, but that should not be the phenomena that we saw. Okay, so client is connecting, shortly freezing. That's on purpose, okay? And that's fine. We can move the guy. Now it's actually looking anyway more healthy. Yeah, now okay, that's working again. So what you see essentially now is that what you see in the server screen in the bottom or in the top right, sorry, you see a lot of input messages from the client, but you see only very very seldomly there is a message coming back from the server to the client. Here we have one now. Yeah. Okay. So that's, I think that logic, I got that right. So what we still have, I mean, we're still putting a lot of strain on the CPU by just spamming out all this stuff. I mean, it's a bit of a problem because I actually want to have this kind of very verbose output. But of course, that also puts some strain. And it also shows the second thing that still on the client we have that kind of behavior where we send just a ridiculous amount of update messages to the client, which you normally shouldn't do. Okay, let's just let him run again. Okay, but I mean, what we also now see, and I hope you see it and you don't, it's just isn't completely lost because the stream is laggy anyway, but it shows very, very nicely that when the server is updating only actually 10 times per second, because that's what we do here, the movement is much more laggy now, because the client really gets an update only each 10 seconds. And there's a second phenomena that you see here. So if you now look at the bottom right screen, you see that the ranges of the update of the X coordinate, they are much more coarse grained, so they're much bigger now. So we have much more jumps, and that's just exactly what we see, that now you just don't move very smoothly from one pixel to the next, but we jump now by several pixels, and that's just a phenomena of the like induced lag that we have now by just sending the latest information each 10 times a second only. So this is now the problem, or this is the downside of having this. But anyway, I will suggest the following. We will just maybe do a compromise for today, because I wanted to do slightly different things today than just to go completely into optimizing. Because that's a longer topic, and I maybe also want to try things out before, and so that it's not such a stumbling around for you viewers. So what I will do now is a second measurement, so that it's better for the stream, and I will also reduce the number of messages going from the client to the server. Let's do that. And then we will just kind of live for today with that with that lag in the game. So I hope you don't have a lag in the stream, but we will live with some lag in the game, and we will have at least one or two, or I don't know how many dedicated streams to battle that lag, because then we go into the area of client-side movement prediction, lag compensation techniques, and all these things, and that just affords a lot of plumbing in the whole infrastructure of the network, because we have to really rebuild quite a lot. And for today, I just plan to do some more gameplay stuff, and like one player is encountering the other and maybe sending an attack to the other, and we just reduce some health points. That was actually the goal to have, so that people see, okay, there is actually something that is resembling some gameplay actually going on, even if it's laggy. I mean, it's fine under quotes. Because we will just battle that later. So let's move to the client. Let's move to the client and maybe close down the server in between so that things can breathe better. And let's essentially build that in as well. So now we will do one thing. We will. Hum, pa, pum, pa, pum. So where is the sending actually? Yeah, so here is the send the input data to the server. Only 10 times per second for now. So what we need to do now in the future is essentially compress the information that we gathered in the last 100 milliseconds into the packets sent to the server. So what we will do is just have a similar setup here. So we will just say that So that should essentially be now do the same basic thing as the server does. So we now might have even more lag if I'm not completely on the wrong track. But yeah, I mean, let's see if it's somehow acceptable or not. Okay, I mean, it's not even building, so that's not a problem. yeah, of course, because I'm not on the server and I was just doing some copy paste stuff. So you see that that's not a good thing. And yeah, actually it is more like this. I mean, I could also essentially reuse that function. I mean, I will probably just not do it now. So we should be able to reuse that function anyway. I just don't want to kind of be too much sidetracked now. Let's just see how that turns out. We should be able to use that function client as well, because we are doing UDP. So that should not make a difference. So there is a question from Decameron. How long did it take to get familiar with Vim? That's hard to say. I mean, I use it quite a long time, and I'm by far no expert. But I would say, so it kind of took me some time, and I never got really into it because I didn't use it long enough. But then I was biting through, so to say, and I was like using it for, I think, and that was not so much. I think I was actually using it quite intense during some holidays, and I think it was essentially between 2, 3, 4 days where I just said to myself, okay, even if I break my fingers, I will just stick with it. And I only know very few commands, so if there is a Vim guru watching, he will cringe essentially. But for me, it took these 3, 4 days, and then I had my, like, I don't know, 5, 10 basic commands in it, and I really like it now. And if I, with my small command knowledge that I have, if I am in a normal editor, I always tend to do those Vim commands, and of course they don't work, but I really enjoy not having to remove my fingers actually from the normal typing position. If you get used to that, and I think if you stuck through it really like only some days, I think it's enough. And maybe it takes, I don't know, 1 or 2 weeks, but I think for sure not more. Then the muscle memory is built up, and just stick through it. I mean, it really feels totally unnatural the first times, but when you have it, it's really cool. It's really nice. And I'm just using, I don't know, 1% of the functionality, but it's already cool for me. It's already nice. Okay, let's try if it builds now. Okay, so first server, then client. So so let's see now. Everything is much calmer now. I mean, I believe. I think it is. Yeah. So now, essentially, you see, we're even kind of lockstep now. So let's then make actually. Yeah. Okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So for me, the funny thing is, I tried Emacs not so long ago. Because I saw some people are using it very, very efficiently, but for me Emacs is completely like strange at the moment still. And I didn't make this phase of like sticking through it. I have to do it, because I think Emacs is also quite cool actually. And I used even a like a specific plugin or a specific mode in Emacs where I can actually use the same how do you call it, the same bindings like in Vim. So maybe that's not the right thing to do, but yeah, but that's what I did. So not using Emacs really in the way it was intended, I guess. So back to the thing here now is we see that so I'm freezing it each time I click here. It's kind of frozen, which is nice. So you see now we have the same like or almost the same ratio between client messages and server messages. Before we had like almost like 10 messages from the client for one message from the server, and now we have like one on one more or less. And I will try now to maybe play around a bit to see if that is actually working stable. Yes, that's evil mode. Exactly. Evil mode it is called. Yes, exactly. To see if we get the right ratio, and just to understand it a bit better. Before that, I will just try out how the movement feels now. And it feels completely out of sync, but that may also be because I kind of delayed the threads completely. I will just play around a bit here, and let's say that it's just yeah, no problem, Decameron. That's no problem. I think that's one of the purposes of these kind of live coding streams, so that we discuss all these things. That's absolutely no problem. That's no problem. So let's just say that we do that. We do that. I don't know. Oops. Do that twice the frequency now. I think I wouldn't have had to rebuild the server now. But anyway. So let's see how that looks like now. Yeah, and I think it's okay now. Okay, something is not okay. We're not moving at all anymore, so let's see. I mean, because I would expect that it's kind of super laggy in the game, but I would not expect it to not work anymore. So I'm pressing now the X key for several seconds, and now I will just quickly check. Okay, so we're moving slowly from 80 to 81. I mean, it's just super slow. Maybe that's the problem because it's not so laggy. Yeah, okay, now you see the guy moving. Okay, so that's a problem. What we're doing now is seems like we're not compensating for the longer time that we wait, which I'm not sure why that is the case, because that shouldn't actually be the case. I mean, let's look at it. Let's look at it. If you That should actually not be the case. Because still we get the local input, okay? I mean, that hasn't changed. That did not change anyway. And we collect it into the input data. Yeah, okay. No. It's clear. I mean, yeah, of course. I mean, we are not sending like positional data. We are just really sending commands, of course. That's what we agreed on. And yeah, and we are essentially just sending the commands and in a very low frequency. And so let's just orient ourselves a bit. What we're now encountering. I mean, it's basically working as designed, but now we are really getting a bit earlier than expected or earlier than planned, but well, what the hell? Doesn't matter. to the nitty-gritty area of that whole network programming stuff. So what we did before, and I'm just thinking of a good way to draw that. Let's say this is a timeline. So there is like T0 and there is whatever, Tn. And we had, and let's say these are the frames. And let's say that, yeah, we are running around. I think we're running around. I mean, at a minimum, I think we're running it at much higher frames per second, but let's assume so we would have 60 of them in 1 second. So what we had in the setup before, it was that like we really sent an update for concerning input each frame from the client to the server. And so that was how it was before, and now we have it like this essentially. We send it here and then we send it, I don't know. So while we did the summarization on the client, on the server side, sorry, on the server side in this frequency, and like we got here, so like on the oops, come on, on the server it looked, in the first case it looked like, yeah, like plus whatever 0.05 and plus 0.0.0.01, but we had this like duck 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 all the time. So in the same period of time, of course, we sum up much 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 more, and we are at, I don't know, 0.05, let's say net movement. That is actually registered by the server and then played back. And now in the same time frame, we just have like 0.1 one time plus, and we just have 0.01 net movement. And so, this is the gap here. So what you would need to do is to essentially compensate for the longer time. And for example, there's a naive way, and now we get into probably into even measuring time and stuff like this. And I wanted not to deal with this today. Let's see, because that really is a big topic. It's a very important topic, and I think if we open it up, if you open it now or if we start it now, it might move in a lot of different ways. And I still try to kind of avoid this, because I would kind of like really redo a lot of the small network layer I have, and yeah, quite not sure. Let's see if we can get away with some cheap trick. I mean, we can always, of course, hard code stuff, because we now know now that we, as we are like the masters and the owners of the client and the server code, of course, we can just compensate for that. So we just know that this is just coming at a much lower rate, and we will just, for example, go to the server again, and just, I mean, let's do it at least a bit nicer. Let's call this let's make the float to avoid any rounding issues. Let's call it, I mean, lag compensation is maybe a bad name. Let's call it, I don't know, let's call it the movement factor. It's super generic, doesn't really make much sense, but let's just call it like this. And we'll just, each time when you write bad code, like bad variable names, you need to to comment much much more. Then this just compensates for the lower input update frequency from the client that we are running now. due to the fact we otherwise kill the live stream. So we will now just help ourselves with this kind of brute force appliance of this factor. Okay, how did I call it? A movement factor. Okay. So, but you see, there is much better ways to do that in Vim, but I'm still confused sometimes. But I still enjoy it. I mean, I still have a net win, let's say, by using it. And I already had a lot of colleagues, like and friends, telling me when they watch me actually watch using Vim, they told me, "Ah, why? I mean, you're really crappy. Why are you doing it?" And I said, "Yeah, but I still enjoy it." So, anyways, okay, let's see if that actually helps us. And that's on the server, so we need to rebuild that. Okay. So, let's see how that now works. I mean, it's slightly better. And now we can play around a bit with that compensation factor, that we get something that is a bit more satisfying. Okay. And now we can play around with that a bit. And I will just like do that like this. But I need to rebuild. And now I will run the client again. Oh yeah, and now it's, I mean, it's still kind of laggy, and I think we can even up it more, but it's getting in the right direction. So let's probably get to something more extreme now, and let's just see how that works. Yeah, and you see, I hope you see, it is laggy also for me, but it's at least somehow, it's getting a bit more responsive, let's say, and let's even do it that way, and yeah, let's also have a look at the I had our wonderful statistics here. Okay, I will. I think what is also a problem might be that I had the video preview open. I think that also is. Yeah, so that is a problem because I had that open in the Edge browser here. So that's now maybe also better if I don't do that. Yeah, seems so. Or maybe even, I think I should pause that. Maybe that's even better. Let's see. Yeah, okay. Yeah, you really have to do a lot of bookkeeping with all the apps that are running there. Streaming is obviously very taxing on the system, of course. Okay, so let's just see if we let's see how far we can We can move now with two clients actually. Now with that. Did I rebuild? I'm not sure. I think I did not rebuild. Let's rebuild the server quickly. And let's just see. Okay, with that compensation, it's better. And now let's start the challenge. Start a second client again. Let's see. Please tell me when we're completely lagging behind again. So, project C++ MMO game. So, yeah, I mean it's actually, yeah, I mean it's really better. I mean it's crappy as hell, and it's super laggy anyway. But let's. But it's at least somehow workable. So you see, I mean, it's super jumping around, and that's not only your stream now. It's also here, of course. But I'm really like, yeah. But it's not. It is better. I mean, it is a bit better. So if you would now have a nice lag compensation system in place, which I will do really now, maybe as the next thing, because it's really like horrible to watch it now. So you really see the need for it. You really see the need. But what we saw, and that's maybe quite a good lesson to see here live, is to see that so when you reduce the number of exchange messages, it really brings it down from completely totally unusable. I mean, the computer was super dead, and we had I think 5, 10 seconds lag before the guy even moved here, that small sprite. And now I think the lag is below 1 second before it starts to move, and that's already something. And that shows a bit it's an example of the strategies you just use to have these things work much better. Okay, but let's put a bit less load on ourselves in the stream. So it might now take a bit of time again to to catch up. I hope I didn't completely kill the stream again. I really hope. But anyway, let's continue now. I mean, I think as we are approaching like the 2 hour line, which is normally like what I want to have is the maximum time. Let's set another goal. What I would like to see is, let's say if you have two clients and then we have both clients open. So what you saw, we only rendered now the local client. So, but you also want to see the other guy, and so that would be the first time that we actually see the full game state, because the game state is currently consisting of two players and actually of their position. There is not much more, and so this is now my goal for today to really render on both clients now, because more than two clients is that's just not that will not be doable. So to render the whole game state that we have now on the clients, and that's already something then. So how to do that actually? So we need to enhance a bit on the protocol, of course. So let's have a quick look back to how the protocol looks like now. So the protocol looks like this. So The message from the server to the client consists of 9 bytes. The first is the message type, which is 9, which says, okay, it's a game state update. And the other 2 bytes are the x and y coordinates in 32 bit, so like 4 bytes each. So what we will do now is to like add several new bytes essentially. So what we will do now, and probably I will just do that in another nice color, and I will just really add it here. So what we add is, the first thing is that at byte index number 9, we add the, let's add the number of, let's say, other players. So that is just like total players. I don't know, maybe that isn't even very useful, but let's just do it for now. That's like total players minus one, essentially, for each one, because each client gets this information. And then he will know essentially how many position informations are going to follow, and we will just say each position information will also be a 4 byte or 32-bit integer. Okay, so that is then x of the other player number one, that's the y of the other player number one, and then if there is more than one player, then it goes on like this. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3, 4. So that is the x of player two, and that is the y of player two. Okay, let's say that we enhance the, that's how we enhance our protocol. Okay. So let's do this. Let's go to the server side. And let's again do this step by step, just in small pieces. I think it's more understandable, and I need to do it in small pieces anyway. So let's see. Okay, so let's continue with that. So we need to essentially change the game update. I mean, there's several things now we need to take into consideration. So here we are. Here we are at the game data, and we are at position 9, essentially, index 9. And what we put there is the number of other players. And the number of other players, and we do that now, not hard coded, we do that already in a dynamic way. So we know that this is the players map.size output minus one. So that gives us the number of players, the number of other players essentially. And then at game data, that's wrong. Game data, I'm sorry. Then we need to do this, right? Okay, now we need to enter a loop actually. And yeah, I'm just thinking of how we do that in the best possible way. Just give me a second, I will just look that up. How can we look over the, how can we iterate over the values of a map? in C++. I think I looked that up 1,000 times. I think it worked all the time. I'm not completely sure, because I know from Java that you can actually say, okay, it's a map, but just give me all the keys or give me all the values, and then you just iterate over it. But I think in C++ it's maybe not so easy. Let's just see. And if that is not easy, I will just make a second data structure where I will also store all the player information, and that's just not a problem then. Map iterate over values. I hope it's not completely complicated. Maybe there will just be some something with iterators, I guess. And probably you cannot use that nice for each loop. We'll just quickly look that up. Just give me a second. Oh yeah, okay. I think it actually could work quite nicely. Let's just see. So we write that loop, and it just says essentially maybe let's do it like this. I think that was a standard string, and that was a pointer to player. So that's our, let's say that's our element, and that's just our player's map. And then we essentially just, I mean, let's just log stuff out so that we see it. Yeah, let's see if that works. And then we can see. I think it's a f first and second. That's how this works. And let's just do it like this. And probably this as well. And we have the ID, and we have the position X. So what we have now is the element second. So the first should be the key, and the second should be the. Well, let's actually just print out the keys. Let's see if that works. Element first, and we will see anyway. Sorry. And then we just. Okay, just that it has something. Let's see if that actually builds. I'm quite sure it does not, and I'm right. Oh yeah. Did I do? Conversion from standard pair. Okay, now I'm really trying. I don't know if that will really work. And probably I should try that out in a different spot here in the code, so where I can see it easier. But yeah, let's just try that out. Let's just try it out anyway. So Ah yeah, I mean that's of course that was stupid. I have to give it a standard C string here. And yeah, probably I should use streams. know, but okay. Yeah, so that actually looks, yeah, that looks good because that's exactly the format of our key. So that's the host IP encoded in an integer, and then it's the port number in network byte order. So kind of completely strange, but maybe it's even the correct one. I don't know. I don't care. So, but that's actually okay. Thing still works. Yeah, and now you see, just want to mention that because of the nature of our protocol, the nature of the protocol is now that we are not super generic, let's say. So maybe we should rebuild that right away. I think it might make sense to do that. Yeah, but somehow, you know, we have this like we have these first two areas here in the code that we have them in the in the protocol, sorry. We have them. We have them like a very proprietary. We say, okay, these are the positions of the local player, and then we say, okay, the next ones are dynamically just all the other players. And yeah, so because of that, what that means now when we iterate now over all the players, also the local player is in it, of course. And we have to somehow find that out now. I mean, it's not so complicated. We can essentially just compare on the key. And if the key, if the element first equals the, where is that now? Yeah, that player here. That unique player network key, essentially, which we build up there. So here we build the unique player network key for the current, for the player of which we receive the current packet. Okay. So, I mean, I'm just thinking if that even makes sense. Yeah. I mean, yeah. I mean, we are really, because we are. Because of our kind of crazy logic, we are just sending it out to that one client anyway. So we will definitely change that in the next session because that's just not the right thing to do. Because we should publish the state to all the clients. Yeah. So we will do that much nicer next time. So, but for now, just to get it working, and we just move on. In small steps. So if that is the first key, then actually continue with that loop and just don't do anything else. Do actually something. Do an STL net write 32 actually off. Let's make that a bit nicer. Do a hard cast here, so let's say that's a remote player equals the element, the second element, so like the value element, and we just need to cast it. I am quite sure. Maybe it even knows it, but let's try. And then we write out of that remote player the position x. And then we write it at game data. And now we need a small counting variable. And that is now like we know it's 9 plus, like the offset is remote player offset, because we need now an offset that is changing dynamically depending on the number of players we have. Let's start with zero. So that's nine. Nine is the index of the play map size. So we want to add let's actually start with 10. And then we start and then we add four times the remote yes. Four times the remote player offset. That should be okay. And then we can even do that. Yeah, we could even do it inline, but I think that's a bit too much trickery. And then we just increase it here and increment it. Okay. So let's see. Just a quick check. We are at okay. Yeah. I mean it's more or less OBS and that's just like that's just what it takes. That could actually work. Let's maybe also print out the player offset. And then we need to also calculate the length here, of course. So things get a bit more complicated now, but that's the nature of it. So we the length is now essentially it is in any case it's 10 because for sure we will have that field and that might be actually zero. Okay, then it's fine. Then we will not add something. But when that is not zero, then we will add essentially 4 bytes, 8 bytes because it's an x and a y coordinate, so like 8 bytes per remote players per player number minus one. So that's 8 times the player's map size, sorry, minus one. So that's a bit, well, let's see if that works. I mean, let's actually make it a bit different. Different. Let's say int len calculated equals exactly this here, and then let's also print it out and let's check if that is actually the right one. Okay, well, let's see. Let's build that stuff. Pa-pam! What is going on? What is going on? STL net, right? Oh, yeah, okay, I think I'm missing a bracket here. But that was not the only problem. So, Yeah, of course, now it's pointer arithmetic, so I have to change that. Right, so, and there is it's 202. I think I need another bracket here as well. So that's the as and that's a four now. That's fine. Okay, so now it's compiling and let's see what is the outcome of that now. So I mean, it's still working. We didn't completely break the protocol. So let's see. Let's have a quick look. Let's pause it here and let's see what is going on. So we have the element key. Sorry, I'm using that as a cursor now. So we have the element key here. That's okay. And POSIX we just didn't fill out. Now we have, that's. Yeah, nothing else because we only have one client. So I'm a bit stupid now. We need to have a second client. Otherwise, we will not go into that other loop. And now we kill the stream again anyway. But now let's see what is going on now. Yeah, the problem is I cannot even see that now. Because it's, but I can stop it here. I mean, it's not looking so bad. Okay, we see we have two element keys here. The player offset is one. And let's just try to add some more information here. But that's not looking not so bad actually. I think we're not totally off. But somehow, So let's also look at look at the position X of that other player, because that will tell us a lot already. And then we just say remote player POSX. Well, let's do that. And then we can see, and then we should actually see a different coordinates between the two players because we'll move the first one, so it's not in the same place. And then we will look at the second one. So now we move that first player up, sorry, down, and to the right, so it's in a different spot. And if you pause it now, it's fine. We don't have a second player. We just have one player. We see it here. There's only one player here. Now let's kill the stream again and let's add a second client. And we see now that that's very good now. Well, that's really okay. So let's quickly analyze that. So we see here. So just if you want to follow, so just maybe look at that in the top right corner. So that's the log of the server. So we got an input message. So I cannot leave the cursor now, so I cannot really show you. But there is the input message in the bottom of the screen, and then there is this player position X, and that's the. And that's the player position of. I mean, it's now hard because we have different input messages kind of mixed together, but that's of the one player, that's of the first player that you see in the top left. So he's 134 to the right, and he's down 174. So he's more deeper in the game world, let's say. And then we see because of our log output that we have two different players. So it's the same IP address encoded in an int, and but it has two different ports. But we see that this player offset one, which is the log output of the first remote player, that is actually the number of the So that's position X, that's 80, and 80 we know, or I know, that this is the like the default starting position. So that's actually right. So that could actually work. Let's just close it down before the stream goes completely to its knees, if it is not already. So let's quickly move to the client again, and let's see if we can pull something out there. So that's where we do that. Yeah, so now we again we're kind of doing the mirror of actions now on the client. So we were writing on the server, now we're reading from the client. And so we'll just so this was like reading out the information concerning our local player, because that's how the protocol looks like. Sorry. Reading out the information for the local player. And now we read out the information for all other players. So players that are not controlled by the local client, essentially. And this we have to do. So first we have to know that. Yeah, we have to know that. So we have to read out the byte number 9. And this gives us the number of other players. And this is written in the game state at index number 9. And let's just write that out now in the client, just to see if that still works. So the server is fine, we can keep that even, and we will just rebuild the client. And we will rebuild our game. Number of other players, 2. Wow, okay, that's not correct. That's not correct. No, it is. Actually, it is. Actually, it is. It actually is working because we did not stop the server, so the server still kept the state. And essentially, in the history of the game, I mean, it's not completely right, but it's also not completely wrong. In the history of the game, that's of that server running, that's a third client that is connecting. So that's why, from the point of view of that. Of that client now it's two other players. So let's start again for a short period of time another client. So that should then say number of other players actually 3 in both of the clients. And you already see it very cool. It is working in both clients. So we see it here. It says number of players is 3 and number of players is 3. Okay. Let's see if we can still move the guy. Yeah, we can. I mean, laggy as hell, but we can do that. And let's stop that now. Okay, so that works. At least that information is there, and I mean that was not so hard to do. And now we just can enter a kind of a loop. Let's just make a very simple loop. I smaller than number of other players, and now we just pull out some information. We just pull out some information from that game state array. So let's think now. how do we calculate this? So we now know that the first the position X of that first other player, that's actually the in the first 4 bytes that follow the byte index 9. So we will do an sqlnet read 32 from game state, and this is now 10 plus I times 4, if I'm not mistaken. So why is that? Sorry, 10 plus, oops. So that would give, for the first player, that would give essentially index 10, which is correct. And for the second player, it would give 10 plus 8. Sorry, 10 plus 4, which is also correct. So that should be... No, it's not correct. It's 8 because... Yeah, because we need to jump over two 32-bit portions. But let's see. Let's see. Yeah, let's for now. I think I will probably not even render it today. Quite tired. But let's just pull out these x and y values correctly, and I will take care for rendering them in the next time. But we are then like very close. But I would now have to store all these values in a vector or something, and I think that's that's too much now. It's already almost 2.5 hours for streaming. Yeah. And probably, yeah, we'll redo it next time. But let's still read it out. So let's say that's let's just say that's an unsigned int. 32 actually. Other x equals that, and let's say the other y. Let's just make that work. And that's essentially the same thing, but just with the offset 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, and that should work, I guess. So the other x is just this, and the other y is just this. Oh, let's see. And let's not restart the server. Let's see how how stable that works. Okay. Yeah, I think there is something missing here. Okay. So we are looking at which thing. Let's look at that now. So we have a very strange other x. Yeah, let's actually do a bit of bookkeeping. Yeah, let's also see the index of the other player. Other player, like number. Let's just do it like that, and let's just say that's our counter variable here. So let's just say that's our counter, and let's just. Let's just rebuild that now, and let's start it again. Yeah, and there's something not totally right, I think. I mean, let's just maybe, let's stop the server now and restart it. So we start from zero in terms of the number of players, at least. Yeah, okay, so that's clean, that's okay. Let's make that smaller. Let's start the other client. So now we have one other player. I mean, that's correct. But what does it say? since the other has an x of 80 and a y of 20,633. So there's something wrong with that x, with that y value. Did it move? But they are essentially okay. It did not move. There's something wrong with that y value. And it doesn't even change. So you see in that one window here, it changes the local coordinate, which is fine, which is correct. So we are at 215 locally, and we're moving back up, let's say, and we are at locally 182. Okay, that's fine. So this is it. But the other one is not right. Let's see if the other axis. Yeah. I mean, it's not so bad. And here the local is working, and here the other one is changing, 110, 110. We see a slight leak. So we just have a problem with the other Y, actually. It seems. So something is not okay with the other Y. The other Y. So I think the reading is actually okay. I will just look at the writing. Maybe the writing is not okay. Yeah, I mean it's not written at all. That's the reason. So we write remote player pause Y. And that's game data 14 plus the same thing essentially. That should already be it. And if that works, quite happy already. Let's just see. Let's quickly check this. That looks not much better. So the other one is at 100. I'm at 92, 119. So the other one sees. That's a complete correct. I don't know. Something is still fishy. So I'm locally here at 99. So the other one should move down to 99. Let's concentrate on the X. I mean, that worked before. So the X is locally, it's 89 here, and it's 89 for the other. Okay, that's fine. So that works. The local coordinate here is 106, and that's the other one is also 106. So if I change that to 95, yeah, that's updated. And here the other one is one. So here now we have a local of 109. That's the other one here. Yeah, that's actually no, it's working. It's actually working. So we have 148 locally because that's the screen of that client. I mean, it's confusing on one host, I know. But that's actually, and the other one is 148. Okay. I mean, that's actually working. So that's quite cool. So the only thing left now is to render it, but I think I will really not do that. I will call it a day or call it a night for now. 2.5 hours already in the stream. Let's just do a quick recap. But that's nice. So we have a nice first task in the next stream where we just do the rendering of the complete world state as it is now, which is just all the players and their position, and we just render them. But that's already something. I'm quite happy with that. So let's do a quick recap of what we did. So what were our goals? Our goals have been to fix the multi-byte issues. We did that. I mean, that works. We can go beyond 255. So this is what we did not achieve for sure. So we did not do that. We did not do a PvP encounter. Yeah, we did not do that today because of the problems we had with the performance and with OBS and with the stream and yeah, some viewers told me, okay, the stream is completely dead because I had the server and the client running at once and the second client running in the same time. So therefore, what we did is like a bit improvised instead. It was not planned, but what we did is a bit of performance tuning. Not in the best of ways, but what we did is we reduced the frequency of messages, which was something that I planned to do a bit later, and we did it now in a rather raw way. Frequency reduction. We did that. At least we did that, and that's also a bit of an achievement. And we brought the CPU stress a bit down, and that was a, yeah, I wouldn't call it a success, but it was a it was improving the situation a little bit. Okay, so that means, and let's do that already now. Let's kind of plan day six already. Like day six, that will be normally probably tomorrow, maybe the day after tomorrow. I will see, and I will inform you via the channel feed. But the next thing, let's do that in red. Like the next task is, yeah, next task, render all all player characters. And then we will also promise I will do everything to do the PvP encounter. So like doing some skill and probably even dealing some damage. I mean that will be quite involved. Yeah, let's see if we can do that. I will also rewatch parts of the stream to see if the lagging was like totally unbearable because I hope it was not, but if it was then I need to do something else because then I would need to completely optimize the game and the whole server client interaction in a drastic way, so to say. And let's say so that's option one. And option two is just focus on optimization. So I mean it is like it is a hard constraint to have, let's say, one server running and two clients like in full steam and trying to produce 60 frames per second. But it's actually maybe a good how to say, yeah, I mean it's like anyway we need to be very performant anyway, so it's a good it's a hard check, it's a hard proof, but it's maybe not so bad to try to achieve that anyway. Okay, good. So I say thanks to all of you and thanks for watching, thanks for participation, and yeah, so hopefully see you soon next time.